So we were all kind of saying that they might have a slight edge coming into this, and overall the team fight meta seems to, I would imagine, would benefit OG a lot. So I think that's good, pretty decent summary. I think there's like some shared heroes. That was another one. The Earth Spirit, I think, is going to be one of the big shared heroes between these two.
Earth Spirit's definitely going to come up in this draft. 100%.
All right. Well, on that note, we do have a draft. We'll hop into it now, and we will see. It does look like IG with their first ban. Just flat out get rid of the Naga.
Yeah.
Fine by me.
I think it's fine by everyone.
I think it's fine by everybody.
Apart from Notel, he's probably going, oh, darn it. He would have loved to play.
Yeah, seems like it was their strongest hero, and yeah, OG definitely did their homework.
And exactly as Jack mentioned, and I actually don't think we brought this point, is that IG have been favoring first pick tremendously.
Yes.
So, and they have first pick here and now. And look at that. Yeah, OG doing the homework here.
They did it.
Tinker's got to go. Do not want to give OP that Tinker. I mean, any specialist of Tinker, I mean, once they're able to get the ball rolling, they just become ridiculous in such a, you know, high skill cap hero. Back the other way, Luna's got to go. Again, I'm okay with that.
Here come the big ones, though. The Meepo looks like it's going to be left in if OG does want to go for that kind of play style. And the Abyssal Underlord. We did see him less than I expected at WESG, but I know at ESL he was very dominant.
Yeah, he was pretty much ban-picked. I think one of the highest of all the heroes in the pool.
Who's that at ESL? And Juggernaut, right? At ESL,
him, Jug, Slardar were kind of the top three big ones at ESL.
Also still have that Shadow Demon in the pool, too, if they want to first grab it. But no, Shadow Fiend.
They definitely did their homework. This is the two most played heroes. Yep.
That or
OP
they just,
play.
Like, looked at that note or something.
Not sure.
That's homework.
I mean, yeah. That's some homework. It takes effort.
Yeah, definitely. And, yep, they grabbed the Slardar first.
All right. So something we were definitely expecting. Slardar obviously has been finding huge success for a lot of these Eastern teams, and IG looking to kind of keep that trend going here. So your OG, you see a Slardar come out now. I mean, you were tickling the idea of Meepo, but does that mean they have to commit to a first phase Meepo? Is it because they might just, it might get banned out in the second phase?
It really depends on what playstyle they want to go for this game. They could grab it early on just to be like, bam, Meepo, make them adjust to the whole draft run, or they can save it out. Drow Ranger was left in the pool, though, so they do go for that one since they are on Dire's side as well, and they probably don't want IG to get it with the Slardar.
Yeah, and this is something that OG were very good at. You know, when all the teams were kind of playing the Drow Struts and stuff, OG, they knew exactly what they're doing. They're very good when they picked up kind of like the defensive supports or the supports that are going to aid the push, like Dazzle, the Fly, you know, these kind of signature heroes. I don't know if it's still pick a hero like Dazzle, very much falling off, but then again, so is the Drow Strat, really. It's no longer a threat that a lot of teams are worried about. And this already, it just seems like OG kind of coming back after a break, not really changing much. You know, this is what OG would have done before.
Yeah.
It was something I wanted to talk a bit, like when we were like doing a bit of that pre-show here, is we obviously have seen different experiences for all these teams on how much exposure they have had to 7.0. For the teams that have a little less exposure, like OG, do you fall back on what has worked before and what you have practiced and trained and attuned to, or do you, is Dota Pit, I guess, the time when you want to try to experiment? Right now, it's looking like they're going to go with the former, like just work with what they they were comfortable with before.
It's not like Warlock got hit by any nerfs by any means. It was one of the most dominant heroes at Boston. People were all talking about this Warlock, Fatal Bonds. This is completely ridiculous. I mean, this hero is the king of teamfight.
Yep.
Not even just with the Fatal Bonds, but with a Drow Ranger too for upheaval. You can keep the distance from the Drow Ranger multiple times, and you can just mess with the initiation. Just a very powerful lane. The Warlock is just extremely good still, and I think people have definitely overlooked it since the 7.0 hit.
I just kind of wonder if whereabouts do they pick up Burning Zero if they pick it up early? It's not going to be now. Actually going for the Wyvern themselves. I mean, maybe a little bit of a Meepo deterrent, but I don't know if OG would have picked up a Meepo when they're doing the Drow Warlock kind of lineup. I mean, maybe they would have. I mean, either way, as you mentioned, you know, Wyvern is something that IG play regardless of whether Meepo's coming into the mix or not.
It's also notoriously good against the Drow Ranger, too.
Yes.
You catch anyone outside of that Drow Ranger, she's just going to kill him. So he's formidable there, and with the idea that, you know, in case a Meepo's to come out, now you have, like, two benefits for it. As you were mentioning in the pregame to this, it's just a Q hero. It's a Q hero.
Absolutely.
Someone we saw him play a lot with his time on CDC, so here it is now.
Very comfort pick. It's already a Drow lineup. You know they're probably going to be pretty physical-oriented on their cores, so the freeze is very good versus that. And yeah, like you were mentioning, he's just very good at anybody who's next to Drum Ranger is pretty much dead if you get cursed up.
I wonder if they do ban out Burning's Lifestealer. You know, they've got a Slardar. It's kind of the classic the Chinese teams do. Burning especially, it's one of his heroes. Do they let it slip through? Because I think there's every eventuality that IG will take the Life Stealer as they have Slaughter.
I think they should probably ban it, yeah. They do have the Slaughter, and it's, like you were mentioning, it's Burning's most favorable hero.
So. I mean, that or the Luna he would have loved as well, but they took it out because I knew OG would have taken it.
Yeah.
More favorable than the illustrious AM?
AM. I mean, is that a hero that's in a place at the moment, folks? We just don't see AM picked in pro gaming this patch.
I think he's too slow versus Drow Ranger. I think he's too slow for the most part. I have seen people doing like these different types of builds, trying to incorporate Dominator into like the Manta Rush and stuff like that, but it's just not favorable. Like, why wouldn't you just pick a different hero if he's going to go for that type of fighting style? They actually go for the Darkseer ban, so that's kind of something that we touched a little bit on too, is that the Chinese teams, the Eastern teams, they go for this thing to enable the Slardar before the Blink Dagger, and Darkseer is exactly that.
Well, they will not have access to that now as it's banned out, and we go back the way of IG here, and you compliment the team fight of Warlock. I mean, what do you get to kind of counter back that if you're IG? Do you compliment your own with your own extra oomph of team fight yourselves, or do you look to get something to kind of perplex the Warlock a bit? Because when you think about Warlock and what his weaknesses are, there's a few of them. I mean, working around the cooldown, I guess, would be one of them. Mm-hmm. But how else can you kind of put this Warlock into a bit of an awkward funk?
I think, like Owen said, though, I think Lifestealer is a pretty good, idea for Issa, because it's just this constant fighting. The Slaughter is just infested. Lifestealer is infested inside the Slaughter. You're constantly running at them, and that puts Warlock at a weird position, because if the Warlock does get jumped, he just instantly dies.
I mean, as well, at this point, they're thinking with their ban. I mean, surely you've got to look towards Anna's OD. You know, OD, Anna is amazing at it. OG, they've already banned out like Sniper, Shadowfiend. Heroes that do pretty well in lane against an OD.
Any chance, let's say they ban out the OD, we could still see Anna go for something like that Invoker?
I think it's definitely a possibility. I think the OD is more likely just because of the bans, like Owen mentioned. And it gives you mixed damage. It gives you damage through the freeze as well.
Oh, they banned the Earth Spirit. I mean, you can't fault them on that. I mean, I say it all the time. Jarrett is, without question, in my book at least, the best Earth Spirit player on the planet.
Him and Crit are unbelievable on that hero.
Like, really, really good. So, I mean, but yeah, that does leave the OD out there. I don't know if IG or, like, we got something in the back pocket in case this OD does show himself, but yeah, based on those bans, it seems pretty apparent that it's something that OG just might snag up here.
They might. I mean, OD, also Morana, another hero that great with the Warlock. And some that kind of works nicely against the Wyvern. You've got a huge amount of magical burst, so you can kill Cold Embrace targets. And also, Cold Embrace kind of works as a pseudo setup for the Arrow.
Exactly. Yeah, I was going to say the same thing. Yeah. It's just, it could backfire on you if the Morana is there. So I'm curious to see. No access to the Earth Spirit, so got to get another roaming Jarrett.
They don't go with either of them.
They go with the Dragon Knight.
They go with Dragon Knight. So just more of a push lineup. Easy to group up with the Drow Ranger DK lineup situation. Although Wind River's pretty decent too at that. He's very good at slowing down the pushes once
great
he gets a couple
push.
Levels. Yeah.
I mean, you give that guy, or girl, I'm sorry, an Aether Lens, and he can do that splinter shot from, I think, a different game. It's ridiculous to have the deep push in a safety zone. He'll be able to pull out, so we go back now to IG's side here. You see a DK, you see a Drow Ranger. OG kind of showing their cores already. Now IG can kind of prepare and attune for it. Any notoriously known weak matchups for the DK here?
The Razor, the Viper are the two big ones that stand out, but versus a Drow Ranger, that hero's able to keep its distance from them quite decently. But they are those frontline heroes, too, that work well with the Slardar and Wyvern, because they're just kind of these like beefy frontliners that let your Slardar reinitiate multiple times, and it gives them kind of like a seizure. But they go for the Weaver instead. Not like a crazy amount of lockdown on OG, but they do have the Silence and the Dragon Tail. More minus armor. It's something we've been seeing happen more, like you mentioned, with the Slardar. People tend to drift toward like these Venge, Dazzle, Weavers, things like that just further negate your armor.
All right, we go back to the side of OG here, they got to be considering, I imagine, their Jarex hero possibly soon. So I'm going to get him roaming about a bit.
Still an Ogre.
Ogre is still out there. I've seen teams recently still continue to pull out something like the Tusk from time to time. That was
that's a Jarex hero, isn't it? Yeah.
You mentioned Morana. You know, sometimes we'll see him pull out the Morana and roam around a bit. But they still don't even know IG's mid lane hero and who Jarex might have to contest here, so we'll see if they fall for that or if they're going to try to creep in maybe their offlane setup.
Yeah,
the S4 hero.
Yeah. S4 Nyx, S4 Batrider, probably the two big ones.
He used to play a lot of Axe. Where is Axe now in 7.0? As relevant as he used to be, kind of falling off a bit?
he's still quite prevalent. He has that. He always will have that with position to be able to just jungle. Like, if okay, your lane goes complete to crap, you go to jungle. You've got the runes. You've got your shrine there to defend you as well. Okay, this was another one that we had seen, and it's very good versus the Wyvern. You have your, you know, they kind of set it up for you for your own hooks, and this is a hero that I've been seeing a lot more, especially when being in China. Like we were mentioning, we saw tons of Pudge. Like, this hero just gets super tanky, and he's such a nuisance in fights. Crazy amount of damage potential, and the Ember Spirit being grabbed up.
Oh, goodness.
That's something that they played a few times in the qualifiers for DAC.
Kind of a hard hero to play when you're behind, though. So if OG, like, they're running a Drow Ranger DK line, if they want to be running and taking those tier ones.
Yeah.
So I'm a bit worried, I guess, kind of like just with that Ember pickup, because if Ember gets behind, he struggles immensely to fight now, because everybody's doing the like Blade Mail, Veil builds, and everything like that. So you don't really have a potential to farm up and take it to the super late game and catch up.
And are we banking that this is going to be a mid lane Ember here, looks like?
More than
I think for sure. That's how they ran it before.
You feel pretty good about the Ember DK matchup there? I mean, now it looks like you might have a little bit of a Pudge influence kind of coming into play, so it is something that Ember might have to kind of consider. But outside of that, you think on paper, Ember kind of gets the upper hand? Or?
Yeah. I mean, DK is kind of like that hero where he always just...
Yeah.
He's just kind of there. He's farming. Ember kind of has some kill potential on him, since he has pure magic damage in the early stage, and DK's just got that massive armor, but having a Pudge in the area makes things completely different. And they do go for the Nyx ban. I think that's also in correlation with them picking the Ember, since like Flame Guard, you can just Carapace and get the stuns off very easily with that. And it's just it's an S4 hero. This is the Space Maker.
Whoa!
We got
a lot of core heroes out here.
Ooh. This looks like
who's playing where?
Cloud9 ran these three heroes together too, I think, at WESG: the Weaver, Ember, and
so
Blightstealer.
So support Weaver.
I think he's gonna be support Weaver, support the Wyvern, and then Slaughter on your flame.
My goodness,
I believe so. Yeah.
XXS playing the Slaughter. I mean, he's great on these kind of initiators at Clockwork and other things that he played. Clockwork, Darkseer, are kind of ones that scream out. So Slaughter kind of fits, you know, into a similar sort of role.
Q,
S4 hero now.
Yeah, S4 hero, and I mean...
Clockwork for IG? Clockwork's not so bad.
Oh, Glove for S4.
Okay.
It goes with the axe.
The axe has come out.
Cool.
I mean, maybe ever since the Ember popped out, I mean, Weaver is not looking too much like a possible core hero, but axe now brings that bit of lockdown, too, to make sure they're not going to be able to slip away from trouble. What do we think, guys, based on the draft before us? A funky one coming out from IG, but do you think OG with their Pudge, Drow Ranger, kind of a heavy pace lineup, are they going to be able to get the upper hand here?
I really like the Pudge pick from OG, just because of the way it works for Wyvern with the curse and with the cold embrace. So I'm gonna lean with OG.
I think again, you just can't underestimate Chinese size with the Slaughter Weaver Lifestealer combo. You know, they felt confident getting that Lifestealer through as the last pick. It's one of Bernie's classics. I feel that IG could actually surprise a lot of people here, and I'm going to hedge my bets with them this game.
Nice.
We are excited to see OG. Are they rusty? Are they not? IG coming off a fresh 10-game win streak. Will that streak continue? We'll find out here soon. Let's go ahead and throw it over to our casters right now. We have Toby Wan and Merlini. Take it away, gentlemen.
Dakota, yes, we are here for game one of this best of three between OG and Invictus Gaming. I'm Tubby One, joined by Ben Malini. Woo!
We were hoping for different offlaners, but Axe is pretty good here.
I was hoping for the sweet sensation that was what we commonly refer to as the hooker strat from OG, because they run both the Clockwork as well as the Pudge together. They did this when they first formed this lineup, when Anna first joined them, but I didn't get my wish, and you didn't get your...
It's pretty hard versus the Invictus Gaming line. I like the Lifestealer here against the Pudge, but I think it's going to struggle versus the very high armor of the DK as well as the Axe. But as long as they can get on top of the Drow Ranger, should work out pretty well for them. With their Wyvern, haven't seen her around too much, but first phase in response to Drow, I think is completely appropriate.
30 seconds to
battle. It's just that simple answer to her, if they can get a good curse off, but... The Drow has also been one of these great heroes that finally has some kind of answer to these short-range jump heroes. Like, the only hero I think she has issues with is Slark. And that's just because you're not going to have Dragonlance and Gust really help you enough to get free of the Slark.
Yeah, Dragonlance is going to be pretty important here with the Pike. I've seen Drow Rangers try and, like, kind of get around the Winter Wyvern, Winter's Curse, by building, like, the Axe Maelstrom even earlier, so you don't have that much agility, so your teammates don't destroy you.
Mm-hmm.
The agility is okay, though, because it gives yourself armor, but Yeah. It's always tough playing Drow Ranger versus the Winter Wyvern.
And this support Weaver, it's like we're watching some Virtus Pro stuff. He's here to try and find that kill on the Courier if it's possible. Just delay up Anna's bottle, and he is rushing directly for that bottle. Unlike the Ember who picked up the PMS a little bit earlier on.
And Pudget already in position to perhaps start pulling. He sees that there is one range creep. Makes it much easier if it's a troll camp or a satyr camp already put in position to hook. This makes the offlane so much easier. And one of the reasons why Pudge is a very popular pick.
Missed one.
Yeah, I don't... Ooh, wow, that satyr didn't die.
That's gonna hold the lane out.
At least they know where the Pudge is because of this.
Yeah. No, he's not going to rotate into the mid, but this is also the danger zone, right? Like, this means that S4 is going to have the lane push onto the tower. It's easy levels for him, easy farm for him. And it's less coming into your safe laner. It's less coming the way of Lifestealer.
Yeah, as well as the support, which I'm probably going to have to focus a little bit more on stacking and pulling now. And Jerax has connected a second camp, so there will be two satyr camps slain by Pudge and his creeps.
Man, this is almost two easy levels for Pudge. Like, literally two of them coming in a minute and a half.
Yeah, and then you can get the next bounty rune, and I think you'd be very close to level 3, if not 3 already, just from that.
Mm-hmm. So, good times for him. I was actually worried about that, because normally OG, I've seen in the past, they try and power level up their Pudge by giving him the safe lane, and they give No-Tail a hero that can play more catch-ups, so something like a Naga Siren is something they've gone for in the past, but... With the new camp positions and just the Pudge pulls that have been happening recently, just seem to be working a lot better. Weaver, oh, Jirax, nice time to rotate up. Shikuchi's on cooldown for the moment with the hook over in. That is one simple rotation into the first blood in favor of Ochi.
Yeah, the Weaver Shikuchi didn't try and stay right on top of the Warlock, but Warlock was not scared at all. Pudge made the long trek actually from bottom to top. You'll see a lot of the Pudges hang around for the Bounty Rune around that time, but now that he's gotten his level, it's time to secure his safe lane. They were beating on No-Tail a little bit and hurting his CS.
You can see also the reason to, like you were saying before, like at least you know where the Pudge is going to be when he does that hook, but then you're expecting him to be on bottom lane. With the Observer Ward positioning of IG, they've got it in the bottom lane, and they've got one just sitting close towards this pull area. So they really actually had no idea what was happening.
Yeah, none at all. It's a pretty tough place to expect the Pudge at that time.
Yeah. At least for IG, the top 3 in the CS port, Lifestealer, Slaughter, as well as Ember, are all getting a lot of CS early on. It's neck and neck, like it's only 2, maybe 3 CS difference between all the cores.
Invisibility. IG need to make sure that this Slaughter gets a lot of farm. He's going to be really important. I think he's their main vehicle for the Lifestealer. You can put him inside the Ember Spirit, but I don't think it's as strong as having him in the Slaughter.
S4 found an invis room, but there's nothing you can do with it. The bottom lane's pushing in a little bit too far. Unless Burning does this, walks in close. You need a couple of lucky spins to come out here from S4. He only gets 2 of them. And even with Burning taking damage from the tower, it's not enough for a kill.
He's out of regen, and he is not close to level 6. So they're either going to have to cold embrace him or
Anna.
Go to the sanctuary.
Under the tower, he doesn't have stun. He's got one bottle charge available. He's trying to get the bug off his back. It's going to be too much negative armor plus the damage that comes from it. So now, with Shikuchi being triggered, Anna, he doesn't have enough to breathe fire. He's short by 7. Potentially, with a level 2 up, he might have been able to kill off the Weaver.
Anna really wants to go to that shrine. Jerax smoked up.
He's moving down. Waiting for a bounty room maneuver. Jumps up. So Ember Spirit turns on the Flame Guard. He does have Searing Chains available. But doesn't want to commit to the fight.
Yeah, I think it would have been pretty risky for him to go for that kill. He didn't know like how high Dragon Knight's HP was. So could have been easily there with a stun afterwards.
Love this from S4. He actually locked his boots, so he doesn't complete up his tranquil boots while he's still farming the camp. He has everything transferred over and then unlocks. Small little things. Efficiency.
Efficiency indeed. Ember Spirit. I don't see the 3 points in Searing Chains too often. More often than not, it's a Flame Guard. But I think you want as much magic damage as you can versus Dragon Knight, and the Flame Guard might not stay alive long enough for him.
Mm-hmm. Fly's been having a decent time as well in his support.
Yeah, it's quiet lane for him. It's great.
Weaver's been funding a lot of CS to himself. But it's also this buff up. Like, the fact that Fly is able to rotate off top lane and they give the entire lane to the Drow Ranger, this is something Slaughter can't really fight without help, and help is, in fact, now on the way. The Wyvern is returning to the top lane. And it's not just the Wyvern. They're bringing a lot of friends north. But they're also bringing them right over the top of that OG Observer Ward. And this opens up OG. So they understand the movement's coming to top lane. They TP out Drow, so no-tell. Heads to bottom lane, instantly scattered by the Observer Ward of IG. And Ana is attacking into the mid.
This is one of the most important moments in the game. Like, when they're trying to gank your Drow Ranger, and then you avoid the gank, and then you get a lot of tower damage in the side lanes. Like, if he doesn't TP, it could just be, like, a slow down the game by like a good 5 minutes or so, because they can't push. They lost a Drow Ranger. No one has precision aura. It's just a very bad
set of spirit. Three spirits committed. Trying to go on the DK, but where's your stun? DK starts his TB out. Ana is away to safety. There just was no more control once the Steering Chains was committed.
Nice play from Dragon Knight. Sometimes you'll see like a casual belt of strength just for those sort of scenarios where you just need the right amount of HP to survive the gank, but he did it without, despite OP going for max Searing Chains.
Smaller problem for the Winter Wyvern. S4's moving over, but Georax not really looking to fight just yet. The Drow Ranger's just cracked, or actually is just shy of cracking her level 6. So one more creep has to die in her presence.
Dyer's top tower. Yeah, they're trying to sack her while they get a little bit more farm of the axe. And he can get his Blink Dagger.
Yeah, there's that 6 up now. This is really good for IG. Almost finished up that tier 1 tower on top. And Fly doesn't really want to force a fight this early on. He doesn't have his level 6 yet, so with no Chaotic Offering, it's still not the greatest time for OG to fight. But IG, this is terrific for them. Farm coming into the Slaughter. A Slaughter who's not going to be delayed on his Blink Dagger.
Yeah, he has a lot of farm. I think he might even get his a little bit faster than S4's at this rate.
Well, this is the reason, too, why the Chinese have so much success on the Slaughter. They always find that farm priority for him early on.
Yeah, Slaughter's fairly useless without a blink at, like, 10-15 as you go on further into the game.
A golden thread. Georax is watching Burning Farm. He'll actually miss the hook, even with the Observer Ward down. Unable to hit the target.
He has to be careful. Like, later on in the fights, you don't really want to hook Lifestealer. It's an easy way for him to get in if he has his Rage up. Doesn't even need to use any cooldowns at the start.
Seems easy, though, if Georax can get it, and then you get the Gust just like that from No-Tail. Trying to hit the combination.
They have Cold Embrace, too. Attack. I don't know. That's not the easiest kill at all. He actually doesn't have that much armor, though. He opted for the other pieces of the armlet first, not the Helm of Iron Will, so he doesn't have that plus 5 armor. So, perhaps.
Robo was thinking about going over the river, realizing with the Pudge standing guard, it's not really worth it.
I wonder if Jerax means to have his Tranquil Boots still in his backpack. This happens probably more often than you think. It's not like he's hitting creeps right now, so he's not really getting... Okay, he knows. He knows what's up.
Yep. It kind of makes sense, though. Like, yeah, if you're hitting creeps, you just switch it to your stash, right? Like, that shouldn't put it on cooldown.
Mm-hmm. Axe jungles, you'll see that very often. Like, S4's kind of doing it right now as he's waiting for it to come off.
Yeah, he actually takes, like, the regeneration for a short period of time.
Yeah, you want to try and time your Tranquil Boots so when you finish the camp, it'll come off that cooldown. But it's kind of tough because Axe is pretty RNG. When he clears the camp.
It's fun watching this duel between the Weaver as well as the Pudge. They're both trying to rotate and have influence inside the lanes, but they're both almost stalking each other across the map. So Georax is going to finally find some space up on this top lane that's going to help him get closer towards the Dismember. And with that lockdown, OG's gank potential is a lot scarier. But it also feels like Ana is baiting in the mid.
Yeah, both... Yep. Heroes are about to hit their level 6.
Spirit jump. Double TP's coming in. So Ana starts with the stun. Remember, he's still got those couple of one charges up his sleeve. But back out. No-Tail actually TP's in for this too. The Ember Spirit. He's got that defensive spirit now up.
S4 was trying to pick up his Blink Dagger. He was a little bit too far behind for that fight. So looks like Slaughter also has his Blink Dagger right before 10 minutes time. There is an Observer Ward behind the tower that will scout out Slaughter's Blink Dagger. So that will come as no surprise to OG. And OG still have the element of surprise with axes up his sleeve.
There's the Blink Crush over on the DK. Got a lot of one charges up his sleeve. Fly, he has the Chaotic Offering. He wants to try and fight this in S4. He's coming in with a Blink Dagger and double damage runes are burning. Sassy attack onto the Dragon Knight. Jirak still waiting. Now the Blink Crush forward hits the Drow Ranger. And then a big scurry away for XXS. Back over to the Radiant side of the river. So everybody from either side have been brought in. OG have the one small advantage. They can trigger off the Shrine. IG already triggered theirs before that fight began. So they're going to come back in and try and force this building down.
They definitely want to fight with the Chaotic Offering right now. And it's a fairly high level.
S4, nice. Blink, Call, and with the Gust as well. Ember Spirit won't take any more damage thanks to Cold Embrace. They drop down the Golem, connect him up with the Fatal Bonds, hook back in from GRX. Doesn't have his Dismember available. He still don't have level 6 on that Pudge, but it won't matter. Now he'll have it. Oh, actually, just shy of it. The kill of the Winter Wyvern wasn't enough for the Lifestealer. The stun, the Gust, perfect on the Slaughter. Even called back in. He couldn't get the Crush off. That could have been life-saving. He'll get it off, but Axe will still have the spin. Bobo thinking about coming back into the fight, but it won't happen. Lifestealer was able to punch his ticket to freedom thanks to Infest. But that's a tier 1 tower, and what was that? A straight trade-off?
They don't have enough levels on the Winter Wyvern. He's only level 5 right now. He needs to be kind of on par with the Warlock so they can turn around with the Winter's Curse. But he tanked the hook so that Ember Spirit didn't get hooked. That was actually pretty close by Jerex trying to nail him as he was remnanting away. But you can't start off the fight like that with Ember having, what, like a quarter of his HP available to him. Mm-hmm. I like the Drow Ranger's play too. She just right-clicked the tower down to make sure to stay like kind of away from the fight so that everyone would have the precision aura up from her marksmanship.
Smart positioning from Notel. Of course, we expect that from him. He's Mr. Consistent for OG.
Yeah, and he always follows up with a Gust under the Ember Spirit too. It just makes his life extremely difficult. Not sure what build the Ember is going to go. We mostly see Veil first. I think the armor is pretty good here, but he might want to consider a way to deal with the silence and or the DK stun, neither of which Veil really helps for. I guess he can tank up, and they have Cold Embrace, so maybe he can still just go to standard build.
Oh, Fly is not walking the right way to help out his teammates. Notel doesn't have a repositioner, so the Blink crush forward, a lot of open wounds, and Notel knows he's dead. Turns for a bit of gas and a bit of damage onto the Weaver, but very smart movement from IG. A three-man smoke rotation committed for it, but now they've got five heroes ready to attack the tier 1 tower on bot.
And they have good wards to set up too. They place one right next to the shrine to see if backup's coming around. S4 in a pretty good position to catch heroes. I don't think he can actually blink far enough to go on heroes on the south side of the tower, but he is...
If he can hold burning close towards the tower, they might have a better chance to fight this. But IG's positioning is just so good, and with Winter's Curse up, OG have to be really careful. They jump in with all the heroes, they're just going to end up killing each other.
And Fly has set up sentry wards on the pruner to make sure that they don't have vision on that backside.
Right, Burning's already left, so IG won't force the issue any further. You find that Observer Ward with the sentry. But Burning's trying to finish up his Echo Saber before probably the next engagement.
There's a lot of things that IG need to worry about when pushing this tower. Firstly, Chaotic Offerings coming off cooldown in 5 seconds. That's a big teamfight ultimate that you don't really want to fight into. And secondly, the positioning of the Axe and the Pudge, it just makes it very, very difficult to actually beat on the tower and feel safe at the same time. No-tail.
Oh, Call is nice. Gust as well. Weaver push back a little bit further. They can't bring him in range for Culling Blade just yet, so Anna needs to get that stun off and hold the Weaver in position, which allows that Culling Blade to happen. And now a little bit of damage into the tier 1 tower. If Anna tanks this, No-tail can kill it.
Boboka had kind of no business being there. He just walked right on top of the Drow Ranger.
Oh, Jirak. If he can get this hook as well, he was just coming over to try and contest the Bounty Rune. So gets the hook into the Dismember with Rot turned on. Winter Wyvern will have to Cold Embrace to try and survive this. Might buy enough time for Ember Spirit to arrive. OP is connected through Fatal Bonds. Not quite certain what to. But Anna also in through the side. Breathe Fire will get the kill over on the Wyvern. So it was a trade-off. So he was connected to the mid lane with the Fatal Bonds.
OG's getting a lot more objectives off of this, and they don't even have to expend Rock for that bottom tower. They do have to use Dragonform. That's still going to be down for a good 60-70 seconds for them.
But it's still a really good farm for Burning. Top tower is under attack. So that Echo Saver we're talking about is now completed. So 14-15 minutes in, get the casual Blightstone and Armlet and Echo Saver with Phase Boots. So that's a lot of maneuverability plus the initiation combo with Slaughter.
I think this that amount of farm on those two is compounded by the problem that Drow actually does not have that much farm. She really needs a pike so she can just push herself away from when Lifestealer jumps on her, or they're going to have to rely on other external factors like Warlock, Chaotic Offering, or a Blink Axe Call, which you might not necessarily want to use onto the Drow Ranger that early into the fight. You want her to be self-sufficient.
Crush, and that's one very dead fly. S4 actually blinked in to get the Cold Dragon Lime to the close to the Tier 2 town, but he's got friends in the form of the Ember Spirit and OG. They not only lose their Warlock, they lose their axe and their tier 1 tower as well.
Lifestealer and Slardar at work.
It's a ruthless combination. There's a reason why the Chinese have such a high win rate when they run this 3-position Slardar. You talk about important moments in the game, but 15 minutes in, you're able to take big initiations on tankier calls, and then you can just move yourself over. This might be a little bit more difficult than they anticipate, but with the Observe Ward up next to the Shrine, they understand what OG is up to. They know they burned to smoke, and that sentry was too far out, so Fly will have to drop another one if he wants to find the other obs.
And they will find it. Yeah. So they know everything kind of that happened there. It was too suspicious because IG backed off right as soon as they smoked down the hill, so they need to have vision back on.
Does OG try and take this themselves? Like, they have Chaotic Offering up, and you've just picked up an Arcane Rune on the DK.
I think it's very, very compromising because of the Winter Wyvern. If Winter Wyvern gets a half-decent ult, which is very easy inside the pit, they're going to be in a lot of trouble. S4 is also not at full HP because he just took out an Ancient Stag, so you don't have all your team members fighting at full health. You don't really want to use a Shrine, I think, for one person. They do have the Warlock heal to top them off, but ideally you'd have an Urn plus a Warlock heal, so you'd be in fighting shape. And looks like Slaughter has been reinfested with the Lifestealer inside of him. Lifestealer is way ahead of the Drow Ranger.
Yep. 7.7k net worth for him. Overall, the advantage is not as high up for IG as I thought it was going to be. Like, it's hovering around that 1.5 for gold and 1k for experience. Blink in the crush. Okay, that timing was a little bit off. Anna gets the stun off. Remember, there's still a Lifestealer inside that, but the Weaver caught and dunked down. Just like she get the buff up and the hook in. Can then she get the disable off on the Winter Wyvern? He never got the curse off, so Anna can move away. Armor toggle down with the Feather Bonds are all connected. Slaughter is dying right now. He almost died. If Jurek can get this hook, he waits for it, but the blink just in the nick of time.
That was a perfect rock from Fly. I think Winter Wyvern was about to get at least a 3-man curse, I believe. But he didn't get it off in time because the stun came as the hook was falling down, or as the hook was coming in. And that is a lot of gold going the way of OG.
Yep.
I don't really think they can contest this rush unless they get a really good Winter Wyvern ultimate, but how's he just going to walk in there?
The crush is off. S4, look for the call. Won't happen. The curse is only on a solo S4. This won't achieve anything, and Notown was initiated on by Bernie, but now is Bernie on the wrong side. The tracks, Fatal Bonds will connect him to the Winter Wyvern. Support is there in the form of the Slana, not to mention you've got a small little Weaver running around the back lines. If they can keep the stuns on him, then maybe they got a chance with a Gust. The Sans is there. Pudge will go down to Bernie, but you've lost your Weaver. Back over the fight next to the Shrine. Too early on the dunk, he's just trying to kill off Burning S4. He just didn't have enough damage. Burning didn't toggle at the right time for him. And now is Notel realizing with open wounds, Lifestealer, he's going to run right over them. DK has to armor toggle his way to freedom too. So we're in two different fights. The Cold Embrace allowing Lifestealer to survive just that little bit longer. Your Fatal burns them up, bounce them up, and this will be a sacrifice in from Fly. And IG, they successfully contest the death of Roshan.
OG split up when they kind of retreated. Like, half of them went up into the river, and then half of them went to the right into the shrine. And the Weaver was in the back line, keeping track of the Gyro Ranger just so he could be in melee range and sacrifice his life. But in the meantime, the Ember and the Lifestealer just went on the back lines on the right side. IG will finally claim the prize, Roshan.
I was actually waiting for Jiren to go for the Hulk, because he moved into the right position for it. He got around the back of the Ancient area, and he could hook into the edge of the pit from there and have the Ancients work a little bit for you.
I think without Aether Lens, it's...
Yeah, it was a low percentage chance. But you can still see him itching for it.
Low percentage play.
Just arrived a little too late. Yes, it is. It's accurate. What do you want about, Ben?
Low percentage might be overestimating it, Toby. Hook doesn't go that far. Are you a punch player?
Sometimes, actually. I definitely have a lot of experience getting hooked by Pudge.
I think as does every Dota player. Congratulations, Toby. You play Dota.
He's the hero of the patch. Yes.
I think he's a support of the patch, at least in pubs.
100% win rate and low priority.
A golden thread. That's an easy way to tell people, too. Just take their creep wave away from their lane. Mm-hmm. I think you can do it in, what, two out of three? Actually, I guess you can pull all three of the lanes on either side.
OG are grouping up. They're looking for something. Now, the scan came on bottom lane, so Anna's going to show himself now. So IG already thinking that OG were planning something here. Now, with the Slaughter, it looks too juicy to go in on the DK. Way too juicy. And Anna needs another 30 gold, and then he's got his own Blink Dagger. So there's that stun initiation that comes from Anna, or at least his ability to keep up with the Axe.
It's hard to Blink initiate, though, because of the Winter Wyvern. Winter Wyvern with the Cold Embrace just kind of stops everything in their tracks.
Is he going for it? Ooh, okay. Ships in the night.
They need an Observer Ward over there. That would make things a lot better. Q maybe going to drop it over here. But
where are all their Obs? Like, they put one defensive one inside their jungle, but every other Obs for IG is timed out. And OG have been very defensive with their wards. Up on the hillsides, around their own shrines near Roshan, and one deeper in their jungle, which times out in a second. Or five.
Yeah, I don't think they want to fight. The shrine's up, which makes the fight a whole lot more difficult for them.
OG is also really close to finishing up the Hurricane Pike, and having that maneuverability on the Drow Ranger, forcing something before you've got that is maybe not the greatest idea.
I think that's the most important item on the side of OG. They need to keep the Drow Ranger alive. She needs to scale as well as the Lifestealer is going to steal in this game. Scale.
Whoops. S4 Blademail called, but didn't blink.
Dire's bottom tower is under
attack. Missed initiation timing he was hoping for over on the Axe. Durax, quick hook into the gust, doesn't get the silence over on Burning, which was the desired effect. Denial of the tower, perfect
Dire's
from No Tail.
Tower has been denied.
Yeah, great timing from him. That should almost be his Hurricane Pike too. They don't really want to fight into the Aegis of the Lifestealer unless it's in a really well fortified position. I think the T2 is actually worse to defend than the T1 because the T1, they have the high ground ward and they have the shrine available to them. But the T2, the shrine is kind of just not really an option, and you're retreating onto the low ground if you have to back off from the fight. I like the Blademail build. Armor is really key here, so he can survive the burst, and hopefully Ember Spirit won't have to get Cold Embraced by the Winter Wyvern. You don't really want to reveal your position that early as a Winter Wyvern in the fight. You want to set up for that perfect Winter's Curse. Mm-hmm. I don't even know who you curse
Fresh mate.
It's pretty tough.
Slaughter's on the hunt. You're going to go around the back. Yeah, the Weaver's going to die, but kind of wait.
They don't have Observer Wards. Like, who's he going to jump? The Dragonite has a blink.
Well, they see him now. They blink him in, but Fly is still in the neighborhood, so he'll drop down the rock, starts with the Feather Bonds, Anna, out of Dragon form, and then quickly speed himself away, and with a double gust from No Tail. Remember, they're all still connected. Axe will get the call off. Support's coming in. The dunk was a little bit too early, so Burning, protected by the Cold Embrace, but he's got no other teammates with him. So now you're able to get Aegis the Immortal up, or burnt, called in, and then just a quick maneuver down the mid lane with the Dragon form up. Okay, maybe not that quick. Durax dropping down a little bit low, but thanks to Ghost Edric, can protect himself.
OG's showing a tremendous amount of discipline. Like, notice how they only kind of show with the Dragon Knight. They want him to go on Dragon Knight, but they didn't really fight last time, but they know that that's the easiest way for the Norm to fight. Go on the Dragon Knight, counter initiate. He even had a haste in the bottle, so he was not really close to dying at all. And a call will catch out another hero.
It's Weaver once again.
Yeah. And IG just got really impatient going on the DK there. If they had a Observer Ward, they could have just went onto the Warlock, but I think the warding from the Radiant side has just been rather lackluster this game. Jerax almost gets a dismember onto the Ember Spirit.
I'm wondering if that's also the impatience of the failed gank on bottom lane. Like, you went down there, you're looking for a kill, and then you rotate over towards the mid, and it's like, it's another infest I'm committing to make this work. Like, you really need to find a kill from this.
On top of the infest, it's just a lot of time. He's not able to get on top of net worth. Like, he's just 2,000 ahead. He was 2,000 ahead before, but it's when you're in the slight lead with the Aegis, you're supposed to be able to increase that gap even further. And that's before she had the pike. Now with the pike, we actually see a Ghost Scepter next on the quick five for Drow Ranger. Pretty important. There's two ways to go about it. One is force staff your teammate, or one is build armor slash physical mitigation in terms of Ghost Scepter, or I guess you see AC occasionally, not really on Drow Ranger, but other heroes if they do want to tank the Infest Bomb.
Is it still worthwhile also finishing up the full Aether Blade?
I definitely think so. Then you can actually save your Warlock potentially. and it's a lot of agility on the Ethereal Blade. I think that's one of the most underrated parts about the Ethereal Blade, is how much agility it gives.
Mm-hmm. Like, Star Ranger is never going to shrug off agility.
Nope.
Like, right now, she's already giving plus 60 damage to all the range heroes on the field, and that includes the Warlock. And Fly is trying to build himself up for the later portion of the game. 15 experience gain. Confidence in his teammates, they can have some really good fights together.
The thing about him is, like, six all-stats doesn't matter. It's six all-stats is a little over 100 HP. That's not going to save him from death. The mana, not really too useful. 6% attack speed and one armor is not that useful. And they do have a scan. It does hit Ember Spirit is out. He didn't pop any smokes on his way out with the Remnant, but they definitely know what's going on there with the smoke just southwest of that bottom rune spot.
It's actually kind of crazy how hard the DK hits. I was just doing the math then.
Yeah, he hits really hard.
He's got the draw range aura, which is giving him 62, and he's got already the plus 40 in his talent tree. So with just that increase, like, you're already gaining over 100. And he's cranked up to 222, and this is 25, 26 minutes in.
And that's before he toggles on his armlet. Mm-hmm.
This is troublesome for IG, just how much damage being pumped out. But they've had really good initiations. If they can keep that up, if they can find that opening with really good vision, then there's a bit of chance for them.
I think there's a big chance that it could be botched, though. Like, if Drow Ranger pops Ghost Scepter right before they stun, it's going to be really bad. If Pud pops Ghost Scepter right before, it could be really bad. If Dry Rangers manage to force staff that target out, if Warlock manages to drop his rock down before the target dies, like, so many things I think can go wrong for IG in a team fight. And I think the only thing that can go really right for them is one big Winter's Curse, which we actually have not seen yet from Q on this Winter Wyvern. He's struggling to get any sort of mobility item. Generally, you want, like, Blink Glimmer Cape, I would say, is kind of the core items for Winter Wyvern. Occasionally, you'll see Aether Lens, but I think Blink is much better, personally.
But he needs the space to get that. Like, with Splinter Blast, normally you can find a lot of farm.
It's because he tanked too many hooks in the early game, so he died on a couple of those team fights and hasn't been able to survive. Surviving is the best way to accrue gold on a support.
Right, but this Wyvern's not really getting that. So Wyvern needs a little bit more space. And the Ember Spirit's still building in, so he's going for a Maelstrom. So normally with the Spellcaster, we've been seeing them going more Radiance kind of style.
I think they just want something now. Radiance is, I think, definitely better if you can get to 50, 55 minutes into the game. But I think that there's going to come this point where OG come bursting down with their BKBs and their big mid-game items and try and take Roche and bully down all these two towers and then the Shrine. And Ember wants to be prepared for that moment.
Doesn't it mess you up a little bit, though? Because then you got both Blade Mail as well as Maelstrom. Like, I suppose you can finish the Maelstrom into a Mjolnir.
What's wrong with having Blade Mail and Maelstrom?
Just because your item slots are going to get a little bit clogged up.
It synergizes really well with his talents, first of all. Mm. You get the cooldown reduction, and you get the spell amp. We're very good on both of those. And on top of that, you have the BOTs, so you're much less cramped for space than other heroes. He still has one spot left even after that. Still has bottle for, like, Octarine, and then upgrade the Maelstrom to Mjolnir. So he still has a lot of room to grow before he even considers running out of slots. And on top of that, they give the Aegis to Burning generally, so he's not going to need that sixth slot for that. I'm just more concerned about, like, the Ghost Scepters. The Ghost Scepters are going to be pretty disruptive in the team fights, as well as the Hurricane Pike. So I think Radiance would have been better for them in the team fights, but not, of course, if they fight in the next 5 minutes when he wouldn't have the Radiance to begin with.
And then it's up to IG to try and hold off before the fight. Like, right now, they're keeping the pressure on top lane by just combining the Weaver as well as the Wyvern together, forcing into the tier 2 tower. Like, you throw out Bugs Galore. Keeps a Creep Wave at bay, then Splinter Blast as well. OG always on the defense. And OG actually farming inside their own jungle, so not even able to utilize the lanes at the moment. Gives a lot more space to the Ember, who is by far the top net worth. He's up there by about 2k. Yeah, 1.5k.
And number 2 and 3 on net worth are the Lifestealer and the Dragonite, both competing to carry that AC as soon as possible. Lifestealer has won that war, picking up his AC just about 30 seconds ago, and DK is very close to his. So a lot of these minus armor and plus armor canceling each other out.
Well, fresh full staff up.
Top lane, blink call, blade mail.
Weaver should still have more than enough time to time lapse out.
But there's no one else coming from IG, so S4 initiates. Thanks to IG's nice ward inside the Dire jungle, they can see Jirax moving over, and Jirax is going to feel pretty comfortable. Like, that sentry ward's only just out of range of the obs. So they're not going to feel watched in that area.
Yeah, he's going to feel pretty good about that. Or pretty good in that area, at least. So, Infest inside the Slaughter, I want to make use of this AC. Roshan is right about to respawn, about the 10-minute mark. But both teams, neither teams do... No, it's spawn. No. I'm surprised there's no HUD in this game. I guess it's not that surprising given the heroes, but I can't remember the last game I've seen without a Helmet Dominator on either side.
Well, the Axe is going for an Octarine instead of the Dominator. So, you didn't even get that from him. Oh, sorry, for the pipe or anything like that.
I like the cooldown reduction, for sure.
That's a blind blink.
So Roshan going to be up
yep.
now. Well, it's been up, but both teams, it's probably about the time at least get wind of Roshan being up, trying to get that gank with the Infest. But there are no easy targets, and IG still with a lack of good vision onto the Dire side of the map. They had that one ward close to the top bounty room, but that's really not going to see anyone. OG would much rather be closer to the Roshan area than up in that area. I guess maybe they might take the T1, but that's kind of unnecessary at this point. They can just use precision armor to push out the lanes. Onotel already tried that 60 seconds ago.
But for now, IG seem like they're the ones to at least start the fight. If OG can't keep dodging this and being put in bad position. So Roshan gets pinged out once again. That's the Dire scanning on top of Roshan. Probably hoping that someone's gonna walk through the pit, and yeah, it just pinged off. So they understand that someone's gone inside the pit, but it's already too late. With all that amplification, all the damage onto Roshan, the hook will fly in, but it's too late. Burning is the Aegis the Immortal, and the damage is done.
They thought they were clear with that green scan, because the Lifestealer and the Slaughter blinked inside, so they didn't actually trigger the scan.
I guess they came through the back end. But this is great for IG now. Now they actually have a license to fight. They still have to be careful, even with an Aegis the Immortal. It won't help you if you get caught out by Warlock's Golem. If that rock drops right on top of you, then yeah, you're going to lose your entire team. And the Aegis is just more of like that extra thing at the end
that
OG just have to kill off.
That's exactly what happened last time. They need to be able to kill the supports on the side of OG. And Pudge is also very good at locking down a Lifestealer during the Rage and keeping him from being a big threat in team fights.
Well, they get the gust off. Anna finds the Ember Spirit. They hook him back into this member, plus the call. Ember Spirit, there goes your rock. Stunning over the Slaughter. The cold arrow will connect, which slows him up enough, which maybe S4 can catch him. But then the curse, it only catches the Dragonite. Another gust. So you can say goodbye to the Slaughter. Jirax will miss his hook. And that's because the Weaver running back past the tier 2 tower, up into the corner. No one is nearby with a stun. They will be able to cancel off that TP. But the Ember Spirit and the Slaughter, they had the casualties. You keep the Aegis up.
It looks like Ember was like not in that great of a position there, but he felt pretty safe because that's kind of where they had control of earlier. That's where their earlier ward was. But mostly it's because the Winter Wyvern doesn't have any items. He wasn't able to save him from getting Blink Stun into Hook into Dismember, which is how he died. Jirax turns around and he's burning. He's out there.
He holds him. Burning. Okay, look at all the life coming back in. But S4, he'll get the call off. This allows Notel more time to attack, but not when Wyvern gives the cold embrace. They have to go for another gust. Don't let him back inside that rage. Long cooldown for 2 more seconds of the hook down. They have enough damage. They'll burn the Aegis the Immortal. Weaver's now here to help out, but the Dragonite's rotating into the mid. They put down the Sentry Ward, so they see the Weaver. So Blink, Call, and OG change the targets. They don't get the Cull. Oops! That's not the hero we meant to hook, but it won't matter if Notel can keep the control on him with a 4-star from the Slaughter. Space being created by Burning, but he's being stunned up, and now with the extra help maybe from the Slaughter, but no S4. Another fantastic call. The Llama's just watching the action. Prime pole position. OP will be able to get 2 of the kills, but Jirax will finally put him down. OG with 3 heroes up, all on low life. The Slaughter would love a crack at this. He's got the 4-star and Blink Dagger available. So Blink, amplification up, but he's got no other friends, or does he? The curse is out. Anna will turn around and actually end Jirax's spree. And we go once again, looking for the crush. Blink off cooldown right now. But even with, all the Dragon Blood armor, Anna's careful, and he's back.
Winter Iron was so close to his Blink Dagger then, but IG going in 3v5 at that point. Wyvern didn't have a blink, so she was trying to run away, but a Dragon Knight just chased her down with a Blink Dagger and just killed the Winter Wyvern. And Lifesteal was just out left on his lonesome. Get gusted into calls, into stuns. They have plenty of control that can deal with the fairly long cooldown on the Rage. And he is very farmed, but he didn't have hardly any uptime in that fight, starting off with the Ghost Scepter and the Hurricane Pike onto the Pudge. So, firstly, they just need to work together a little bit more. Use the Slaughter to lock people down so that you can kill them inside the Slithering Crush. You don't want time for them to be able to drop the Rock, use Force Staff, use Ghost Scepter. You just need to kill them straight up at the start of the fight. That's the most important thing. The second thing is the Winter Wyvern needs to be in position for a good Cold Embrace and a good Winter's Curse. It's extremely difficult because of the tough game that he's had in the last 30 minutes and because of how keen OG are at hunting him down, but he is one of the most important heroes in these team fights. Like Warlock, he's generally just going to be very safe in the back. He even has a little bit of evasion from the Solar Crest, so that's I actually like that build a lot. It will help a lot with the burst from the Life Slitter, but you can kind of pretty much count on him getting off his spells. It's more of Winter Wyvern being the wild card in these team fights that IG need to pull through.
Yeah. And if they can't use him, maybe they can actually just get OG to expend a large amount of their abilities with the Aghanim Scepter completed over on Weaver. This is going to make OG's instant kill targets a lot harder to get because this puts Axe in a rough position. He has to know where that Weaver is at all times.
Yeah, they're mostly counter-initiating though. I don't think the Axe Weaver is as good this game as in most of the other games. I think it's really good if they like constantly kill and jump a target over and over.
Jirex! Allo! Gets the hook! Perfect Gust follow-up.
Yeah. Poor Winter's Wyvern. But yeah, if the Winter Wyvern's not really doing anything, then they definitely need the Weaver to step up that defensive role. Slack.
Wyvern was just a little bit too far forward. Now Anna with 40 seconds without a Wyvern, a blink call. That's a big one, but nope. Not able to find it. Amber Spirit able to get away as they just chain up the back line of OG. But no Talon just attacked from the low ground. Anna's fine. He can actually continue to tank this up. And he's just worried about the Blink Crush. It's over on Nota, the Hook, trying to actually save. But S4 again has to go in for the call. They get the Rock Drop as well, not to mention the Gust onto Ember Spirit. Very difficult for IG to keep pumping out this damage. Well, they keep getting controlled and silenced up. But now they have the opportunity. Chaotic Offering is down. They want to go for a kill. And that's why Slaughter moving quickly forward. Four staffs over, jumps up, gets the crush off. S4 will drop. Anna's trying to help out. Nortel has to push himself away from burning and goes up to TP away to safety. Anna's also creating space but doesn't have a TP scroll available. It's still inside of his stash or inside of his backpack. So he'll have to be the sacrificial lamb to keep the Drow Ranger alive. Fly will fall as well. And that's actually a gem of True Sight being lost. A lot of heroes from OG falling for very little gain.
Really nice play from the Ember Spirit. He's going in really, really deep and using the Blade Mail to keep himself alive while being able to play very, very aggressively. And now he has pretty much all the items that he needs. He's just missing level 25, I would say, at this point to be a complete nuisance. And this is... I thought they were going to push a lot after that chain feed in the mid lane, but now I think IG right back in. Unfortunately for them, no Roshan going to be available for them, but... I don't know. Having that gem is going to be very problematic. The Drought Ranger probably thought she would get a lot more mileage out of her Shadow Blade. But Notale probably feeling sad about the gem loss, and he's constantly just having to sit in the trees and not hit creeps.
Yeah, it's really not a happy time for Drought Ranger. But at the Tier 2 tower, it's a great time for IG. Keep the pressure on, keep pushing down with a Blink Dagger on Ember. It can always initiate in, doesn't rely on the Slaughter.
They just need
and
the...
finally, you're actually going to get the Blink Dagger on the Wyvern.
Oh yeah, that...
Wow.
Yep. A little bit late for him, but better late than never.
You only need one really good ulti from him to help like IG, I don't say win the game, but definitely gain full control of this map.
Yes.
And that's what they do. Like, they just push down the mid lane. Now Ember Spirit gets the farm at the bottom. He'll jump back to his Remnant in a bit, and then probably join the rest of his teammates still securing the Roshan area.
Yeah, it's still a very tight game. Ember Spirit really trying to prioritize his level 25. I think once he gets the Mjolnir too, if he puts him on the Slardo or the Lifestealer, like that. You can just kind of run in with that hero, not really care about, not really care about anything. Or you can just put on the Ember Spirit himself. You can just Life Leech off the Maelstrom procs and just be a complete nuisance in the fight. So there is no BKB on the Drow Ranger. And there finally is one on the Dragon Knight, so Drow Ranger is going to be the primary target to focus down if you're IG and save if you're OG.
The Gem of True Sight carry is finally coming out to get that Observer Ward.
This is going to be a very blind OG. So with the death of this Observer Ward, they actually don't have any real vision anymore. It's only the creep waves they have to work with.
Slaughter looks like he's going to be hunting for the Drow Ranger. He has Shadow Bladed up, but No-Tail is in the trees, and there is no smoke and no Drow Ranger, so XSS will actually TP to the Shrine to look for a kill on a way far out.
Yeah, Anna is trying to be again be this bait. He got Vel Discorded up, and they jumped to the back lines, pushing forward. Do they have enough? They've already brought down Fly, and now S4 into the cover of the BKB. Can maybe help out his teammate Anna, who's inside the river, but split in multiple parts. Ember called up again. The Culling Blade a little bit off timing, but it won't matter. The Ember Spirit is down. Does he want to buy it back to try and tilt this fight around? DK, Cold Embraced, actually cursed up for the moment. The Crush will be there. Lifesteal is in, trying to kill off Anna, but again, S4 trying to create more space, calling up, blade mailing up. Anna is having to toggle his way through this till finally they get the Crush off at Invictus Gaming. Can they turn this up? S4, he's locked in. He willingly called into that fight. Jurex can at least keep the Slaughter in bay, but Burning moves over towards No-Tail. Instant first bash, so Ghosted will protect him. He's got the Hurricane Pike as well for a little bit of movement speed. Will he get away? Down, gust away? No, it's not enough. Burning will do the work. No need for Ember. This Life Sealer is already too big.
He is really, really big, and he definitely had a lot of support from the Weaver that fight. Weaver actually saved the Winter Wyvern. Winter Wyvern still did not have that greater curse, just a solo curse on Dragonite, but at least it did stop his damage from that fight. But he saved the Winter Wyvern when he was at, like, less than 10% health. Jerex looks like he's trying to go for a kill. Ghost Scepter only going to save you for so long. There is Fly there.
Ooh, they pushed nice. Him up. Fly actually used his four star to get Jerex up the hillside.
See, they're really good about team coordination. Normally, it looked like that was his own four staff that push him up the hill, but it takes a lot of teamwork to be able to call that in the heat of the moment, or just a lot of chemistry. And Burning and Booka, with the help of the Solar Crest and the Swarm, looks like Roshan is taking a beating.
Yeah, this is something you kind of expect when you have Amplification on Roshan as well, but there's no way OG can get here in time. The TPs are coming out from Wyvern.
They probably don't expect it with the Slaughter down, but there's so much physical damage that it is super easy. And that will be a cheese. I'm not sure who they're going to give it to.
It's him Burning at the moment.
I think he passes to Ember. Ember, I think, gets a lot more value out of the HP. Burning already has a lot of ways to save himself, I think. And
it looks like it ended up in the hands of Weaver. It's sitting in his backpack for now.
I think this Weaver actually needs to die pretty early on in the fight. He is very, very annoying with the time lapse. I take back what I said about him not being like completely or like super useful with the Ags. That Ags is just incredible. And still waiting for that good curse from Q. But at the same time, they're like kind of afraid of it too. So they're like splitting up a little bit more than they would, which means that your damage output is going to be much lower than normal. OG are very well equipped to deal with it.
That looks so fluent from the Slaughter. He four-staffed and then blinked, and it looked like he was never actually in the position at the end of the four-staff. That is smooth, fast, and really difficult to react to by OG. And they found another target. They found Pudge outside the base. The Ghost will wear off in just a second. And OP just holds him there, and obviously he can't hook back up. You're able to get the call over on Live Sealer with the Yule Scepter up and towards the air. Pudge may have a little bit more time. He's got four stuff off cooldown right now, so back up to the hill and far away. But no, you had the Ember Spirit waiting with open blades for him. So the buyback comes in from Anna. That's an expensive one for OG. They really didn't want to have to do that onto their DK. And IG are happy with this. They back out, they get control of the map.
And it looks like they actually want Axe to be probably the secondary or damage dealer, I would say, from OG, because Jarvan is just constantly dying in these fights, so they need someone else to actually take down these really beefy heroes. So Axe, he picked up the damage talent at level 15. It's a lot of damage. 75 damage is a ton. And he's also going for an off-screen play mail build. You'll see that very, very often. But on top of that, the Maelstrom build. A lot of attack speed to synergize Dyer's with that plus damage. And you're almost always going to be getting hit with Axe because of the Berserker's Call. And then with the 7.5 second cooldown on that, he can actually get that to proc a lot in team fights. But it's still a long way from that, and they still have to weather the storm from the Ember, who has hit his peak. He has level 25. It looks like he's going for what, a Lotus or Vez's last choice. It's unusual, but it is good to dispel the silence. I would say reflect the DK stun, although a lot of the time DK does have his BKB on. Mm-hmm. Reflective dismember.
That's kind of odd, as just going for like more stats, more control, or whatever. There's so many options you can go for with
Yeah, him. Usually you'll see Radiance, I would say, is probably the most common 6 slot that you'll see instead of Lotus Orb. But I've seen some other ones. I've seen Lincolns, I've seen Scythes, I've seen... I think that's mostly... I think I've seen someone try and go for like a more crit build. No-Tail in a lot of trouble.
Yeah, he doesn't have an easy way out of this one. He's still got his E-Blade available if he wants to use it. But instead, it's just a quick push and TP away to safety.
That's really scary when your Darranger just drops that low to an Ember Spear who didn't even have any reveal.
Slaughter's on the hunt. Observer and Sentry, and he was running over that with a Shadow Blade, so OG are very aware of where this Slaughter is moving. But of course, when you bring in the Gem Carrier of the Weaver, well, you're going to lose one of those Observer and Sentry combos already.
Burning's really scary. He has so much HP. He has 3470 HP. He went health at level 15 and stats at level 10. So he actually went full defensive. And
that's a very good Anna. No TPs. He is stuck there and dead for a rather long time. 95 seconds without a Dragon Knight. This almost seems like an impossible defense for OG.
Yeah, especially with the Aegis still in hand for the Lifestealer. It's up for one more Jirax. Minute.
That might have been one of the ways to do it. Get that hook onto the Wyvern, bring him down before this fight even begins.
I don't really know what the game plan is for OG here. How do you actually start this fight? I guess kill Ember is probably the best way, but even he has buyback and Remnant back into the fight, so he might not be the best target for him to kill.
There's your jump. S4, able to get that call off. The Ember Spirit trying to keep on top of the Draw Ranger. The hook will pull S4 back to safety, and OP is in rather deep. Jumps himself a little bit further away thanks to the Defensive Spirit. And that's just going to be it, Matt. It's going to be Yule Scepter into a nice hook. It's an easy setup with the Yule Scepter as well, but Burning able to range in time, and now the call is a three-man one-up from S4 with the rocks, the Feather Bonds. The curse is out. It's on the Draw Ranger, but no one's there to attack it. Jirax keeping the Lifestealer under control. S4, he doesn't actually have his Culling Blade, but he needs the extra spins. They'll burn through the Aegis of the Immortal, and now it's buyback time. Out for No-Tail. They still don't have Anna available. A quick hook. It doesn't pull Burning back far enough. Jirax needs to be that proper initiation. Shadow Blade from Slaughter waits for his time to strike. Well, okay, maybe not. He just runs back away. They try and reset the front line. There's Boba right on top of the Draw Ranger. A quick hook actually hits the target. They don't see him, however, and then the Blink Crush. This could be it. If they lose the Draw Ranger right now, OG just won't have the damage. So they push, and they push some more all the way back to base. But no, the Splinter Blast and the Burn is enough to do the work. The Draw is down for 102 seconds. Anna will respawn with Dragon Form available. You'll only want to fight if IG go for more, and it looks like they're doing exactly that, straight to the mid lane.
That's a 5-second Searing Chains for you right there.
Hook. Yeah. Burning. Where's that control? He Lotus Orb, so Jirax can't go for the Dismember. They have to Ghost Step, they have to force off out, but they both get double crushed out. And Anna can toggle his way through this, or can he? The Ember Spirit with the Lightning Shit up. They don't even want to attack him. He's doing so much magical. Even Q on the back lines, on the fly. Jirax is able to bring down the Weaver. But this looks a very sticky situation for OG. Still no Draw Ranger for a full minute.
They do have the Axe backup. Axe is a significant source of damage, so actually maybe they can do something.
Ember
here.
Stunned up. They bring down the Ember. 98 seconds. Jirax forward. Dismembers off cooldown in 1 second time. So they get one. The crush is nice, but Jirax moving over towards the Lifestealer, holding Burning in position with a Breathe Fire. Another Culling Blade. They will lose their melee racks, but IG lose everybody to actually secure it.
Yeah, the Draw Ranger is actually not that important right now. So I think that they got way too excited about just one of their heroes being down. I think they really have to respect the Dragon Knight and the Axe in this situation. They did have a really long time. I think OG did a fantastic job of stalling for as long as they could to try and hope for the Dragon Knight to respawn during that fight. But at the end of the day, it's 2 melee racks, 1 range racks down for OG. Definitely not insurmountable for them, and this seems to be the perfect time for them to push at least a buyback. But they don't have any good tower hitters. Ana is back trying to buy some TP scrolls.
They're bringing in more. With the TP in from S4, he's got those boots of travel now. Actually going for the double boots, one for each foot. Radiant structures are and they just have to keep the pressure on. So you get Lifesteal to buy back. There's a fresh Lotus Orb picked up by the Weaver.
And Jirax, here you go again. Loves to do this with just that Yules into a quick hook. You've got that Lotus Orb, so Pudge can't keep any kind of Dismember going. And then the Winter's Curse is over on the Dragonite. S4 doesn't really do a hell of a lot of damage. Another hook missing from Jirax. Anor is so low, he's got to get this bug off him. Able to do so, now he can actually armor toggle his way through and fly. Drops a rock with the Fatal Bonds. Winter Wyvern. Anor just blinked himself back in again. Weaver's in the middle of this fight too. He doesn't actually have his ultimate to use, so Anor trying to man fight him through. Weaver actually not actually doing it. It's Life Stealer with that quick bash over, and then Dro Ranger. OG, they try to force the issue, and with all the buybacks from IG, they actually defend the OG push.
Oh my god.
And now there's so many heroes down for OG for so long.
What a value shrine user from them. They were like dropping HP during the shrine use, so OG were dumping everything during that 5 seconds, but that shrine just pretty much just gave them two lives at that fight. And I think only Winter Wyvern took a spill at the end of the day, forced to use his buyback, but he's right back in the fight. And now a limited amount of buybacks available for OG, only one more left on the Warlock of all heroes.
You don't want burning. He's got 3.6k life and 49 armor. His last talent point, he actually got the plus 15 armor in.
Well, that Axe is going to be pretty useful for keeping him off the Rex. Or at least that's what Jerex's mentality is. He still has a cheese on the left.
Oh, Blink Crush. Right. It's great if you're alive, but nope, he is dead. Luckily, immortality is going to just be purchased in this game. But only once for now. Jirax again looking for that hook, able to find his target over on the slaughter with a dismember. Flies in the neighborhood, wants to try and fatal bonds up a couple of another hook in from Jirax. He just keeps pulling him off. But Anor having to wait, this hook's going to miss this time around. But they don't really care, IG. They just keep the pressure on. Another hook, a quick slide of fist, able to dodge it. A four staff down, hook going to miss on the slaughter.
One measly Ranger Axe left. That's at 758 HP. That is all that stands in between IG and Mega Creeps.
Whoops. I'm not showing that one again.
So Lifestealer is going to be the main target for them. On top of that, they have to control the Weaver at the same time.
How? He just bought a Blink Dagger. He's now got even more maneuverability on this Weaver.
I mean, how else do you deal with the Axe time lapse? You can't burst a hero down like Lifestealer. Well, you have to kill him before the rage.
Well, the only other choice was to have Anor do what he did, which was to blink into the back lines. And if you do that, then you then put your DK on the chopping block.
Yep. And now they've even shored up that weakness by giving Aegis of the Immortal to the Lifestealer. So in terms of being able to burst him down, that is near impossible right now. And most other heroes that are important on the side of IG have buyback the Sara and the Ember Spirit being those two. I guess Weaver is probably the best target for them to take out now if they can catch him. But as you mentioned, the Blink Dagger, the Lotus Orb, it's going to be tough.
Oh, the Syrian Chains. It's another 5 seconds. Just stay exactly where you are, Anor, and this is one way to get him out. Hook your Dragon Knight away to safety.
There were a lot of creeps there. I'm surprised you got him with that chains.
Remember that Range Ranks is all that stands between OG and, well, Megas. That's not really the end of the game. One team fight is all that really stands, like, lost. Between OG and having to go into the second game of this series, one game down to IG. But IG are definitely looking sharp with this lineup.
I really like the Weaver's play this game. I think Weaver's been a complete nuisance ever since he picked up that Scepter. Even before then, he was like pretty annoying, pushing out the lanes and just constantly being elusive. Like, you don't really want to use a DK stun on him, but generally you have to, I think, to kill him at this stage in the game and earlier.
Here we go again. Burning jumps forward. The Lotus Orb to try and protect him. Try and go straight for the Ranked. S4 able to get the call off with the creep wave there. They turn their attention towards the Ember Spirit. He was dropping low, but then just gets pulled back out. And now it's up to a Lifestealer. Infest dodges a little bit of the damage. Still on the run. Now you got a cold embrace, but it's Anor who really needs some distance. S4, he goes in once again with the Golem behind him and the Gust. Maybe there's enough time. He goes for the Culling Blade too early. All they burn is the Aegis Immortal. Throw Ranger. He got caught inside the curse, but this is a better one from Jirax. With that dismember, the Weaver is gone. That nuisance is removed. But IG are still looking strong. They haven't claimed the Range Racks yet.
IG cannot fight, I don't think, without the Weaver. They lost the Aegis, they lost the Weaver. This is a potential to lose the game right now if this push.
They're going south. In. They're looking for the Blink Crush. Jirax quick in with the Ghost Scepter. You do have that Ember Spirit, a quick four staff up. They're going to chain the stuns off just because that Lotus Orb reflect. No tell. They're looking to lend the Gust again. That Range Racks low. No tell dropping so quickly. They just have the life. They have the power. Jirax will go for a dismember. Maybe with that death of the Slaughter, they can turn this fight around. down, but nope. It looks like it's IG still standing strong. They push in further, but it's the Ember Spirit and Lifesteal, a combo, and there it is. GG is called out. Invictus Gaming take game one against OG.
Jesus, this Ember Spirit was a complete piece of this game. OP, he can play other heroes aside from the Shadow Fiend and the Tinker, which were first targeted by OG in this game. And Drow Ranger just got bullied a little bit too much. Not too much that he can do against the Lifestealer Sorrow constantly on him the entire game.
Well, the panel we're talking about, like OG, this is what they like to do. This is what they did before. You just rinse and repeat 20, 30 minutes in. You just go for this absolutely unstoppable push. And it was stoppable.
7.0 Ember Spirit.
Yeah.
Or 7.01, whatever you want
to
call it.
It is a dawn of a new day. OG, welcome back and welcome to 7.0. That's really their first game on this patch. They'll have game two after the break.